Welcome back. Dynamic or kinetic simulations are basically digital experiments, so digital prototypes, with the advantage of being inexpensive, especially if you want to make several iterations. And even better, you can obtain more information than on a physical test, because you will require a lot of sensor or high-speed cameras in this case, and stuff like that. So I prepared this experiment based on a nice experiment that I saw on internet from the professor Dr. Walter Lewin. So you can find it on the internet if you look for it, and it is a nice class. I recommend it to you. Okay, so what do we have in here? We have a projectile that is working with a mechanism with a spring. So instead of taking my time to make the mechanism of the spring and all that, that's a different story. So what I wanted to do is to just have results that can be compared to the analytical calculations. So this is a kind of easy or basic, but if you want to make complex things, you need first to know how to use the program. And this is a guide basically that is going to give you the confidence, and also it's important to have some math in the background for double check stuff and make sure that the program is behaving correctly. Not because of the program is going to do it bad, is because you could be doing something wrong on the settings of the simulation, and you could be having different results from the thing that you require. Okay, so we have a steel ball that is with this mass, some grams, 13 grams. Then we have, of course, the gravity, and we have the constant for the spring. I have a video for springs in this type of simulation. Here is the link. And we have the compression of the spring. The spring actually, I think, was 70 millimeter, 75 millimeters without compressing, free length. So 40 is the difference of what is it being compressing right now. And we have an initial velocity that we don't know for now. Okay, so let's take a quick look to the setup. So dynamic simulation is super powerful, and it is easy to use when you know what you're doing. Okay, so all these standard joints that you see in here, those are coming from the result of different mates combinations, and those are being defined based on the degrees of freedom that you leave on the assembly. So you are going to need one part that is, for example, fixed. So this one, this base that is supposed to be a rail or something like that, I simplified to just a plate. And then I have this carriage that can move freely on this axis, on the x-axis of this. Let me push this back. And well, this has attached the tube and the cone, and inside them, let me do a section view. Let's do a section view in here. Yeah, there you have the sphere, and you have a part that is the, let's say, the part that is attached to the spring itself, and it is also having degrees of freedom to move in this direction. And this other one, if I turn on their mates, it has no mates, because I'm going to show you how to how to make it work. Okay, I will just let me see. There you go. Okay, so now we are back to the original state where I was before stopping this. Okay, so those mates, if I turn on the mates, are going to define the motion. So you need to make sure that your assembly is having the correct degrees of freedom. Okay, after that, we are going to jump into dynamic simulation, which is a kinematic simulation. Okay, so as you can see, we have a combination of mates creating a prismatic, for example. If I go to the properties, you will note that I have 1 degree of freedom. So just POF, degrees of freedom, just for the translation along the axis. That's correct. And you can also see that we have a current position on it. So this position is from the origin plane or the origin of the coordinate system that is in here. And that's because the plate had been defined at the center symmetrically, and then it is attached to the center of the assembly to the origin plane. So that's why it is having these coordinates. That's something that the program is going to read and leave this value in here. So nothing to do in there more than just know what it is. Then we have something called edit joint force that we are not touching in this case. And then we have the enable imposed motion. So it is a relation, this is a table, let's say, or it could be also a single value, constant value. I have an input grapher I will show in a bit. And basically what you do is to drive these degrees of freedom. The degrees of freedom, you can drive them by selecting the position, velocity, or acceleration. So in my case, I'm doing position because I want to go from the region. Currently, we have 1,400 millimeters from the region. That's why it is important to know where our part is. And I'm traveling to the opposite side of the plate. So minus 1,400 millimeters. And I do it in a terms of 1.6 seconds. So this is extremely fast. So we can check the velocity here. As you can see, I check in this check for the velocity, and now I can see the value of this velocity, as well as I could see the acceleration. Since this is immediate velocity, let's say, it is the same velocity all the way, there is no acceleration in reality. Okay, so that's why it is zero, this blue one. All right, constant velocity, there you go. Okay. Okay, so let's now just cancel this, and then let's jump into the cylindrical one. So this has some different properties because it is basically, it has 2 degrees of freedom, because this is for the, say the part that is the disc that is touching the sphere and in contact with the spring. So it has just movement in this axis. As you can see, this is a kind of highlighting on which translation you are. If I pick on the rotation, it is free to rotate in this direction, which it is not going to affect our calculation. And in this one, this is a trick, a really good trick. So I told you that I was not making any mechanism for resolve this thing, but what I'm doing is to use again the imposed motion using the position. So what I'm doing is to force the position during just the beginning of the move, let's say, to get everything in move with a constant speed. And then what I do is to release the spring. Okay, so as you can see, it is 30 millimeters. Do you remember I mentioned that the length of the spring, or the free length of the spring, was 70 and the compression is 40? Well, there is the other 30 that are going to complement the 70 millimeter of free length of the spring. All right, so how do I release it? Well, as you can see, I have a zone in the center. I have two zones in white. So you can move by clicking in them, or maybe you can use these arrows. So you can move to one or the other. Okay. So currently the left one is a constant value. The one at the center, which is the one that we control with values and different types of ramps and stuff like that. So the following one, that is this one, that is after the 0.2 seconds, I'm leaving it in the free option. If I would like, I could keep it as a constant value, constant slope. If we have a slope in here, well, we have a slope. The thing is that it is zero. We have a module, cylindrical, etc. But we are going to use free. Let me cancel this. I don't want to modify anything. There you go. So yeah, my after 0.2, the spring is going to be free to move. So that's how I activate the spring to extend and give the sphere the projectile motion. Okay, very good. Then the next step, well, oh, sorry, I didn't went over the reason why this sphere was not having mates. And it is as simple as we need, after we are in this environment, the sphere will be part of the grounded part, but I'm giving it a spatial relationship, a spatial joint that is going to make it have a clear, let's say, the define the degrees of freedom, let's say. So I use this option, the first one that appears in here. So it is just basically that. Provide the part with degrees of freedom. If you check, the part is having 6 degrees of freedom. So 3 translation, 3 rotations. All right. Then 2D contacts. Well, I have 2D contacts in between the sphere and the cone and the tube, and the other 2D contact, I don't remember. Oh yeah, of course, is against the disc that is connected to the spring, of course. So those are have been defined with 2D contacts using sketches. Here is a link for a video on which you can see how to set 2D contacts using sketches in this environment. The idea is to avoid to use 3D contacts because that's going to take too long time to solve. So there you have it. If you want to see it, there is the link. Okay, so finally we have the spring. The spring is 70 millimeters free length. This is the value for our spring constant, and we have some damping. Damping is key. By changing the damping, you're going to have different behaviors of this thing, especially when the projectile lands again back into the disc. You are going to notice if you modify that value. So that's also part of the prototyping thing. For example, we will say, okay, let's test different springs. And well, you have to do adjustments to them on the damping. Okay, so it's time to run. So in this value, look or consider that I'm already placing the 1.6 seconds because it doesn't worth it to make it longer. And I'm subdividing this from 0 to 1.6 seconds in 500 steps. So the higher the steps doesn't mean that you're going to have a more precise analysis. It just means that you're going to have more values. So depending on the simulation, sometimes it worked it, but it is very rare, to be honest. 500 in this case, I think the default is 100. I use 500 because I want to have some fine measurement on the total height of the projectile, and we can go even with more, like 3,000, for example. I solved it for 3,000 before doing this video, and it is taking like 20 minutes more, and it doesn't work it because at the end I'm having the same results, and well, with a minor pitch in between them. All right, let's click, and as you can see, it moves very smooth. I will zoom out a little bit. There we have it. Okay, and then well, it finished. End of the story. Okay, so let me push it back. I will do a small zoom so you can see the spring compressing when the thing enters again. There you go. Create a nice path. Okay, so what is this red thing? Well, this red thing is something called trace, and I already defined it before starting the video. So what is a trace? It's a point from where you want to have information, and when you create the trace, you're going to have this dialog box, and you are going to select the reference, and the reference is no more, no less than the coordinate system that you want to use for refer on the values that you are going to have as results. Okay, so there you have all the coordinate systems of all your parts, as well as some extra ones, and the grounded, that is the main origin thing. Okay, you can select which of them, of the values in between trajectory, velocity, and acceleration, you want to see on the output grapher, that is the graph that I'm going to show in a bit. And you can also select to be shown on the trace. So it's like this one right in here, okay? All right, and of course you can select the colors. So why trajectory is staying and the rest is not, is because they are, let's say, a vector. They are a vector, really. Yeah, that's what they are. So vectorial values. So let me push this back a little bit again. So maybe when the sphere, there you go. So as you can see, we have here a green one that is the velocity, and the one that is pulling down is the acceleration. Remember that when the projectile is on the air, the only force that pull it down, or let's say in vertical direction, is the gravity. So let's start there. So if I go to traces and I ask for the acceleration, there you go. You have the value for the gravity. Now, we can look for the for many things in here. So let's start with the velocity. So I will ask for the total velocity. So as you can see, I have two coordinates, which, by the way, the only one that is important are the X and the Z. The Y is not, because the value is zero. It is not displacing, let's say, to the inside of the screen or the outside of the screen. And these two values are going to be, of course, vectorial values that are going to be the total, in this case, the V. So let's turn these ones off. And there you have our velocity. So as you can see, we have some initial thing because the thing is aggressively going to start at ready, accelerated, let's say. So it's this is the what the velocity that the sphere have at the beginning of the movement. So let's you can double click in here, for example, to move this thing. So let's say that we are looking at this thing moving. If we zoom in, let me do this way. Okay, so let's pull this back. Maybe it's very minor. Yeah, it's difficult to see, to be honest. All right, whoop, sorry. Okay, so we are having interest on the initial velocity. So let's say if we go to search max, for example, here is our value for the maximum speed. So I would say this is the value that you will expect to use on the analytical calculation. So let's use this one in here on the math cat, 3813.6 millimeter per second per second, millimeter per second. Okay, all right. So that's our velocity. So then, how about to check on the positions, the X and the Z value, so we can determine the angle of the slope that we require, that is often given on exercises of this type. So how do we get it? It's just by making the difference in between two of the values, you know? So what I'm going to do is, let's say we are have the difference on X. So I will say 370.099 minus 306, 364.47. Say there we have our value, and now let's do it for the Z axis, which will be the vertical one. So again, we have 78.6 minus 67.9, let's say. There you go. So that's the value of our angle, the angle that is formed when we have here in this point, right? So this slope is going to be having this angle. Okay, so with this, we already have values to check. So for example, we have the height. This is classic physics, right? So 580 millimeters. At the output grapher, I'm going to check for the highest point in here. I will search max, and we have 661.5 millimeters. So this is not exactly the value that we have in here, but it is because at the beginning of our simulation, we have an offset against the origin. So I believe it's this one here, yeah. So in from here to here, we should have 55 millimeter. Let me use the measuring tool. Oh, sorry, having a filter. There you go. So from that bottom to this center, there you go. 55.5 millimeters. I already have it in here. So I will provide here the value that the program is reporting, right? So let's say we set the maximum value here. Search max, okay. And now I will say that 661.5, and this is still having a different value, but not by so much. So this kind of things could be adjusted with the spring value, but they are very close in between them, to be honest. Okay, so you can adjust the damping value on the spring if you want to make it fully accurate, perfect, but for now it is okay. Okay, perfect. So then, what other value do we have? So we have this. This should be. Ah, this is the difference in between them. So I'm having a difference of 25.4 millimeters in between the analytical calculation and the value of the program. Yeah, right? So that's okay. All right, then we have the time. But the time will be the time from having contact to the time when we stop having contact on the spring. So let's get this thing back to somewhere like this. Instead of going, just checking if at which point we're going to start looking at the projectile ramping up, we have another way to do it that is verifying with the contact of the joints. So this should be, or should be this one, I think it's this one. So on the points we have forces. So let me turn off for now the velocity. I will leave the position. There you go. So on the 3D contact we have some forces that we can explore, but for now I want to just check the status of the 2D contact. It is like a digital on a PLC, a digital I forgot the name, so don't forget to subscribe. Let's say a digital input, so it is 1 or 0, that's it. So 1, we are having contact, 0, we don't have contact. So let's say that we have here, this is the second when we start is at 0.2. Let's do it the other way around. 0.208 seconds. And we are going to look at the opposite side, the moment when we have contact. So we have a value of half. Let's look how that thing looks in here. So I will say, yeah, there we have values, a value of the contact. So it is super interesting. It's like there is a small push and then touch again and then continue. So this is pretty accurate. I mean, so yeah, let's say that on seconds we're going to be at 0.896 seconds. So the travel takes less than a second. So this is a super quick thing. This is a half meter height, so you can have an idea. Okay, so let's now take a look to the force, because we have a spring force. That's true, totally true, because and easy to measure. So when we are at the beginning, let me say, yeah, something like here. Let me remove the contact status. Contact status. Yeah, there you go. Okay, so we have 14. If we zoom a little bit in here, 14 is going to be at the point where we are still having the spring compressed. So if you remember well, I'm controlling that position, forcing that position until the 0.2 seconds. So this is the last point, the last moment when we are going to have the minus 14 newtons based on the constant of the spring and the compression of the spring. Then we start to have less because it had been released and the spring starts to move, right? So yeah, so there we have the projectile incurs, and let me try to let's say that we are going to take a look at the position, yeah, on the C, yeah, so we can get there faster. Okay, so the idea is that this value is the force that the spring is having when is the force that can't be, let's say, given by the spring back when half the projectile entering again or landing again on the in contact with the plate or with the disc. All right. So the analytical calculation says that it should be 7.4 newtons, and we are having something very similar, 9.5. And if we go here a little bit down, we have the 7.8. So this is the force that is the spring having when the sphere, the ball hits again the disc. There you go. All right, just for finish this video, let's take a look to what happens if we modify the spring damping. So currently it is 0.002. I will change it to 0.001. So I will click OK, and we will simulate again. We will see a difference on the behavior at the landing, especially at the landing. I'm pretty sure. There you go. So it is bouncing way much more than expected. Or well, maybe more than what I will expect. Okay, so let's look for the max value. So as you can see, the force of the spring is exactly the same. If we go to the landing, there you go. So, oh, look at that. It is quite a little bit more accurate. Maybe at the point of touch, it's not the 7.35, but at the, let's say the at that compression is around 7. So it is supposed to be the max, and that makes total sense, to be honest. So let's just update this some of the values so we can see if that change on the spring is making the things to match. So let's go to the velocity. That is the first value that we need to update. So let's search for max. Okay, very quickly. This won't take long. So it is 4,620 millimeter per second. Let's take a quick look to the values. Probably the values for the yeah, we need to check them. Yeah, the position, the X and the Z at that moment. One is 370, and the other one 360. Yeah, pretty nice. And the other one is, yeah, this one is changing. The C one is changing. So it is 82.5, and the other one is 69.3. There you go. We have change on the angle. That's okay. Oh, we didn't check the total distance of the travel. We are going to see it in a bit. Just double checking. Let's see the total height. As you can see, it impacted a lot. So this kind of analytical calculation can help us to do these small adjustments on the springs, because I think they're pretty important. So let's look for the max value on the height. We have a resultant of 1012.77. And we have that it is going to be, yeah, it is increasing the difference in between them. Okay, the other one was 25 millimeters difference. So maybe, oh yes, of course, we're missing something. Okay, so that difference on the height, yeah, those ones are, this is the value, but in reality should be a little bit more if we are going to evaluate that height from the same point. And that point, for me, it should be the point when the ball stops to touch. Okay, let's take a quick look on the 2D status of the contact. 1-4, okay, let's go back to here, somewhere else like this. Yep, it says it is 96.09. There you go. Now the difference is 3 millimeters, 3.8 millimeters, 4 millimeters. There you go. So what I'm doing in here, let me show you graphically. I'm evaluating the thing on the difference, not from the original point in here, I'm doing it in here. And this point, now that we are in here, we can check the total distance in X direction. So let's say from here, we are in X at, let me check, we are in positions, yeah, okay. 1 second, I will have to introduce it here. So it will be X1 is equals to 96, sorry. This is a positive and negative, wow. So 375.7 millimeters from the origin. This doesn't sound right because it is, well, let's take a look. It is from the same origin at the left. Yeah. It is going to be all right. Okay, so now we jump into the value when we have the first contact. So the first contact, as you can see, I think the value of the height in Z in C is exactly the same. So let me get back in here, 95. We check in here, it is, okay, 82, 83 in height, as you can see. When it stops having contact, it is, yeah, this is the value, yeah, 96. When we go at the opposite side and referring always to the status of the 2D contact, we have 95, and the other one was 96, which I think is going to be acceptable. If we run this for more steps, it's going to get closer, I am pretty sure. And now, let me, whoop, I will do the X2. This value in X is 1880.9 millimeters. So if we do the difference in between them, so this, whoops, sorry, this will be X2 minus X1, and this is equal to 1.5 meters. So this value, let me do an annotation, this value is pretty close to this one. So we are on good shape in there. All right. Pretty good. So we could continue checking here, but yeah, we are having good values in here, and this video is taking longer than expected. So you get the idea how to interrogate your dynamic simulation. Be always with analytical calculations, side to side, is very important, very key. For you to make you sure that you are having good results, of course. So thank you so much for watching this video. I hope it has been useful for you. Let me know in the comments if you have questions. I will try to answer them, and see you in the next videos. Cheers.